Hello there, my fellow betrayed friends of the 13th Legion, and welcome back to our coverage of the infamous and bloody Battle of Calth. For today, it is no less than part 8 from our series. Last time, we finally got started on the ground war aspect of the battle, and oh boy, it was terrifying. Ultramarines everywhere got attacked and killed while they were trying to be friendly by the word bearers and their treacherous minions. Today we will continue with this phase of the battle and see what happened next. I am your host, the Grimdark Narrator, and without further ado, let us proceed, shall we? Despite a few small victories, the onset of dusk over the capital city of Numinous appeared to herald the end of the Ultramarines Legion. In just over 12 hours, almost 100,000 Ultramarines had been killed, and the Wordbearers controlled almost every city and strategic location on Calth. With debris from the Orbital Massacre continuing to rain down on the besieged planet, orbital strikes obliterating vast swathes of the landscape, and catastrophic collateral damage caused by the battle between the Legiones Astartes, casualties among the civilian population were beyond nightmarish. Millions and millions of Imperial citizens perished in the fear and agony of the first few hours of the fighting, and millions more continued to die as the fighting carried on. Indeed, the Wordbearer's intent seemed less to persecute the Ultramarines of the 13th Legion than it was to cause wanton damage and destruction as much as possible. This design, for it was not just bloodlust or madness on the part of Lorgar's sons, was intended to facilitate some malign ritual on a grand scale. While the deeper religious connotations of these actions among the Wordbearers remain unknown, the immediate consequences are well documented by the few survivors of the Battle of Calth. Many accounts attest to bizarre aberrant weather patterns during the early stages of the battle, freak typhoons, unnatural aurorae, and cloud cover being the most prevalent. As the death toll mounted and the fighting spread, these phenomena became more pronounced, and the first instances of manifesting warp entities were recorded. Indeed, the Wordbearers seem to have treated their appearance as a vital goal in and of itself, rather than the furtherance of their military campaign. Most of such incursions were noted as occurring in the areas where the fighting was particularly fierce, or the death toll excessively high. Not only were the surviving loyalist elements tormented by the predations of the Wordbearer's allies, but also by the deterioration of the situation in the Viridia system. The Wordbearers had turned the full destructive capability of the Calth orbital defense platforms against the system's sun itself, and the resulting flare in solar radiation was beginning to take its toll on the warriors on Calth's surface. Those not shielded by the sun's glare, or protected by the augmented physiology of the Legiones Astartes, were soon blistered and burned, and would later succumb to extreme radiation poisoning. Only those few enclaves, within one of the few shielded structures still held by the Loyalists, escaped this lingering death. The Grand Cruiser Andromedus survived its unpowered fall through Calth's atmosphere from orbit largely intact, but its blazing bulk demolished a large swathe of the once teeming city of Calcus Fortalus, clearing a patch 2.5 kilometers wide. Meteoric debris continued to rain down from the sky all around it, bombarding the city and the surrounding landscape. Fortunately, Magos Thoran managed to flee the destruction of the watchtower before the large vessel struck the planet's surface. Little information about what had occurred in orbit was available to the Loyalist survivors on the planet's surface. They knew that there was some major incident in orbit that was raining destruction upon the planet, but whether it was an accident or an attack remained unclear. But with the orbital fleet yards gone and all the Vox traffic scrambled, there was no way for the remaining Loyalist units on Calth's surface to communicate with each other or with Ultramarine's command. Eventually, Magos Thoran and her Loyalist Skitari units managed to consolidate with the surviving Ultramarines of the 4th Company, including their commander, Captain Remus Ventanus. Assessing their desperate situation, Ventanus realized he had a vast horde of Chaos Cultists arrayed against his forces, as well as tens of thousands of traitor Astartes. The traitors also possessed battle groups of massive traitor Titan engines within their ranks. Magos Thoron suggested seeking refuge at Lepsius Numinus, the old imperial gubernatorial palace on the plains of Calth. Lepsius Numinus also possessed a non-active but functional data engine, as well as a high-cast Vox transceiver array. Though not currently operational, the equipment had been scrupulously maintained, and because the systems of the palace had been offline when the Wordbearers began their assault, they might have been spared the scrapcode infection. If the 4th Company and their allies could reactivate the data engine at Lepsius Numinus, they might be able to contact what remained of the 13th Legion's fleet in the Viridian system. The plan was successful, and the Loyalists reached the Old Palace. The commander of Thoron's Skitari suggested that they utilize their dedicated emergency manifold to power up the palace's data engine and Vox assembly and contact any surviving Ultramarines, Imperial Army, or Loyalist Mechanicum units. Ventanus eventually established communication with other besieged Ultramarine units. His situation was far from unique. All the Ultramarines on the Calth surface found themselves mired in the same predicament. No one knew what had befallen their Primarch, Robut Gilliman, or even if he was still alive. Even as the 4th Company converged on Lepsius Numinus, a large horde of the traitors, commanded by Morpal Gir, had already encircled the palace and launched an attack against a small group of Valiant defenders. The Wordbearers used their vast hordes of Chaos Cultists like cannon fodder, driving them forward as they protected themselves from any significant counterattack. Terrible carnage was inflicted upon the Loyalist defenders by packs of horrible demons summoned from the Imperium, as they punched through any breaks within the defensive line. As the assault grew even more fierce, the defenders of Lepsius Numinus prepared to sell their lives dearly, but they were spared from the dark fate by the timely arrival of the 4th Company and more heavy armor support. The reinforcements bolstered the defenders' resolve as they tore into the ranks of the traitors and decimated their ranks. In the meantime, Thoron attempted to reactivate the data engine and establish full communication with the remains of the Loyalist fleet. Yet, Ventanus knew that although they were strong in spirit and well-armed, their forces could not repel the traitors' attack indefinitely. It was only a matter of hours before the defenders' position would be overrun. Despite the brutality of the Wordbearer's assault, Thoron focused on her duties and managed to reactivate the dormant data engine. With it, she was able to gather a clear picture of the situation, especially the truly catastrophic scale of their losses, the enormous death toll, the systematic annihilation of the Ultramarine fleet, millions and millions killed, and entire cities aflame, as burning debris plowed into the surface of the planet from orbit. Ventanus finally managed to contact Robut Gilliman directly and provide him with a picture of what remained of the Loyalist forces on Calth. As many as 30,000 Ultramarine Battle Brothers and 200,000 Imperial Army and Mechanicus Warriors were still active in hundreds of scattered pockets of resistance. Coordinated, they could achieve a lot more than if they continued fighting unsupported. In any other circumstances, Calth would have been declared lost to the traitors, but the fierce resolve of the 13th Legion prevented them from giving in to despair. Robut Gilliman believed that the situation could be salvaged, and the Wordbearers made to pay a price that they had not expected. Fortunately, among all this negative information, somehow Magos Thoron managed to discover a kill code that her former mentor, Hest, had hidden within a secure data engine at the Zetsun Varied Fleet Yard, which had been closed off from the rest of the Calf's planetary network. This data engine was the manifest cogitator of the Cargo Handling Guild, which was located in a secure bunker in the industrial zone between Numina Starport and the Lanshear Landing Grounds. It was responsible for running cargo operations for both Numinus and Lanshear, and thus was more than powerful enough to manage the data load of the planetary weapon grid. As a civilian cogitator, it was not a main military target during the Wordbearer's assault, and Hest had been able to take advantage of this before he died. Though he had suffered from the painful overload of the data shock that was killing him, Hest did manage to clean the data engine with his kill code and then keep it severed from the broader planetary network. Contacting Gilliman aboard a flagship, Ventanus appraised the Primarch of the new development. He informed him that the enemy was controlling Calth's planetary defense grid, using a captured data engine on one of the surviving orbital platforms at the Zetsun Verid Yard. Magos Torren would be able to purge the system of the Wordbearer scrap code using the cogitator, but could not access the Cargo Handling Guild's data engine while the Wordbearers remained in control of the platform. They would need assistance from the Ultramarines in orbit to gain control of the platform and perform the purge of the planetary weapon grid. Several plans were debated across the McCrag's honor by the Ultramarine commanders. Shipmaster Hamed recommended a direct bombardment of the platform using the flagship main weaponry. The McCrag's honor certainly did possess enough firepower. Chaptermaster Gage seconded the suggestion. But if they didn't make a direct kill of the Wordbearers holding the platform with the first salvo, there was a real danger that the enemy would retaliate using the planetary defense grid and finish off the Ultramarine flagship. Chaptermaster Claude Empion of the 9th chapter opted instead for a close attack plan. Bring the flagship to full power, throw off the enemy cruiser surrounding it, head straight at the platform and eliminate it at close range, by ramming if necessary. Unfortunately, the moment the massive flagship began to power, it would again become a target for the planetary weapon grid, which could annihilate it all too easily. Finally, Chaptermaster Gage came up with a different plan. Reroute all the crippled warship's available power into the teleporter system, and teleport a kill squad of Ultramarines, possibly two if the power was enough, directly to the Zetsun Verid Yard to take control of the platform from inside. But the implementation of this daring plan will have to wait until the next episode. And this, my friends, has been what I wanted to tell you about the Battle of Calth and the fortunate restoration of communications for the Ultramarines for today. The battle is far from won or even over, but at least some things were beginning to look up for the 13th. Do you have any thoughts, opinions, or questions about this stage of the battle? If so, you can always write them down in the comments below. Was the episode informative or entertaining? In that case, please click the like button and subscribe for future content. And you can also click the bell notification icon to stay a bit more up to date. Thank you very much for watching, and I wish you all a great and peaceful day. The Emperor protects.